color, comprehension, design, color, and paint for everyone. Lecture by Neil Martz. Beethoven's Death Knocking at the Door. What an image. Music is to hearing as color is to seeing.
And I'm going, I won't be back.
Talk about color and music, that's the blues. Hard to not move to that. The point is, music is a big part of our lives, and it gives us a lot of feelings and emotions. But so does color. Nothing like the sensation of smell. Or a bad smell. Let's not forget about tasting our favorite food. Then there's two senses together, taste and smell. Sometimes a little bit sour. So that is a lot of your senses that give you a lot of feelings. Well, sight and seeing give you just as much feelings and emotions. I'm not going to show you a picture of a soldier holding a dead baby. But you get the idea. I am here to talk about color. And, like I said before, color is to seeing as music is to hearing. A lot of us never look in the sky and see all the colors. Walk down the street and not see all the colors. A lot of us will read a sign, but not appreciate all the colors, especially those beautiful browns in the background. In an energy wave, between X-ray, ultraviolet, and infrared, there is visible light, which includes all the colors. Usually in science class, you shined a light through a prism and you saw the spectrum of colors. This was always interesting. Why is the sky blue? Many of my students say because the ocean is blue and it's a reflection. Actually, it's more intriguing and amazing. The sun's rays travel through our atmosphere, which has molecules of water, and those molecules reflect the light like little prisms. If there are a lot of molecules, it turns into clouds. After a rain, when there's a lot of moisture near the ground and the sunlight reflects on it, you'll see beautiful rainbows. The way we see color is explained like this. If you have a white surface, when the light reflects off it, it reflects all the colors of the spectrum. If you have a red surface, the only color that reflects is the red, the rest are absorbed into the surface. If you have a black surface, all the colors are absorbed and you see black. A banana is yellow because when the light hits it, all the colors are absorbed except the yellow wavelength, which is reflected. That is the explanation, but I really don't understand it. This is what's known as a color temperature chart. And if you notice, it's rated in kelvins. Here is another color temperature chart, and at the bottom, you can get an idea of what gives you these color temperatures. Notice 5,000 to 6,000 kelvins is daylight. Sometimes these colors are grouped in warm and cool colors. Everybody's seen this in faucets. Red is hot, blue is cold. Of course, the reason red is hot and blue is cool is because of human emotion, and we'll talk about that later. Everybody has bought light bulbs. Usually you can see warm daylight and cool white bulbs. It's written on the packages. This light bulb is warm at 2700 Kelvin. In all cameras, there's a setting called white balance. This has to do with Kelvin temperature. Years ago, when you bought film, the package used to be blue for cool and red for warm color temperature film. Here is a camera where you can adjust the color temperature. Here is a camera that's made easy. You set the white balance or color temperature at the lighting that you're in. Chapter 2, Designing with Color. Here is a simple color wheel that we're going to start talking about. Here are primary colors, red, yellow, blue. These colors cannot be mixed. In math, it would be prime numbers, 1, 3, 5, 7. From these three colors, all colors of the spectrum can be made. But if they are put together, you can get white light, as in a light bulb, LED, or if they're dark, you can get black. If they're medium values, then you get grays. Since we are talking about designs, here's a room designed in primary colors. Here's a painting designed with primary colors. And here are clothing designs in primary colors. So from primary colors, now we're going to move on to what's obvious, secondary colors. Secondary colors are, if you mix yellow and blue, you get green. If you mix yellow and red, you get orange. And if you mix red and blue, you get purple. In math, these are secondary numbers. 1 and 1 equals 2. Here is a room designed in secondary colors. Here is a poster designed in secondary colors. Here are clothing that are designed in secondary colors. Here's the next thing on the color wheel. Here it's called complementary. Sometimes it's called opposite colors. Strange, but in nature you find many things with opposite colors or complementary colors. Here is a room designed in opposite colors. Here is a poster designed in opposite colors. Here are clothing that are designed in opposite colors or complementary colors, which means complementary means they look good together. They complement each other. Next in design is called analogous colors. It's any three or four colors next to each other. Here's analogous colors in nature. Here are room designs in analogous colors. Here are some clothing designs in analogous colors. There are other design elements. Here's split complementary, intermediate, also called tertiary colors, feeling and emotions of color. Here's a great example of someone on the animation team knew exactly about emotions of color. This is a picture of Dracula's daughter, obviously from a movie. But the use of black and white is really emotional. She's a beautiful actress. It looks like she almost has a halo around her head, like the Virgin Mary. But the costume people knew that black is ominous and scary. What lurks behind black and the dead of night? We also think of black as in funerals. Most often, the bad guys are dressed in black. Maleficent is the bad witch at first. Of course, by the end of the movie, she becomes the good witch, but she's dressed in black in the beginning. Of course, some people say that black is not a color, but a man like Joseph Albers would differ with that, but we'll talk about that later on in the lecture. White is thought of as clean, fresh, new. Sometimes the good guys are dressed with something white. So if you think I'm exaggerating the use of feelings and emotion of color, here is just one chart of what all advertising professionals know. So let's look at red. Red means love, intimacy, energy, sale, passion, anger, and hunger. It's no wonder that many women that are supposed to be sexy are dressed in red. If you look under orange, you see it's health and thirst. Yellow is cheer, fresh, and warmth. Many restaurants are decorated in yellow and orange. Here is another chart about the meaning of color. Here it says cool colors are soothing, restful, and calm. Warm colors are optimistic, active, and vivid. Juxtaposition of colors. A simpler meaning, a color next to another color. This is not trick photography. The two center purples are the same color and value. A color put next to another color can change the look of the colors. Here, the center square reds are the same color and value. Here again, the color squares of red are the same color and value. Here I made a make-believe canvas. When I first learned how to paint, I learned that you have to block out a canvas. It may be called by other names, but for most paintings, not all, to pick the color you want, you first have to paint in all the areas until you can finally pick the actual colors that you want. The idea is, a color juxtaposed to another color changes. Now if I pick this brown, I have a lot better idea of the color brown that I want because of the colors next to it. This artist is blocking out his colors in values. This artist is starting a portrait and is blocking it out in values also. Here is another example of blocking out in values. Here is a really good landscape painter. You should notice that before he paints the realistic trees, the colors on the right-hand side and the foreground are blocked out. Color and paint. The question is, can you see pure red, yellow, or blue? The answer is, only with a scientific laser. Scientifically, they can come up with exactly the spot where pure blue, yellow, or red happens. But when it comes to paint and dyed fabrics, it's almost impossible to find pure red, yellow, or blue. Many pigments are made from minerals. The minerals are ground down, usually dry out and become a powder. Pigments are the color that's added to paint and dyes. Flowers and vegetation are also used to make pigments. Of course, nowadays, they use machines. Also now, they use chemicals to make pigments and dyes. So what does this mean for paint and the color wheel? Because there's no pure yellow in paint, yellow is either going to go to the red side, or yellow is going to go to the blue side. Some people say it goes to the warm side or the cool side, but I think that's best for a weather report. I think it's easier for explaining and seeing that when you look at yellow, it's going to either have a little blue in it, or the yellow is going to have a little red in it. And in red paint, you can't find a pure red, so again, red is going to go to the yellow, or red is going to go to the blue. Again, sorry to be redundant, but the same thing, there is no pure blue, so blue is either going to go to the red side, or blue is going to go to the yellow side. Here are some of the colors I've always used on my palette. Yellow to the red, I like cadmium yellow medium. Although with all the colors I'm going to tell you about, sometimes they change the names, sometimes they discontinue it, and sometimes some manufacturers don't manufacture this color. One manufacturer I know of calls this chrome yellow. The next color I like for yellow to the blue is cadmium yellow light. Again, some manufacturers only make lemon yellow. For red to the yellow, I like cadmium red medium. Although with one manufacturer, the closest they come to cadmium red medium is French red. Red to the blue is one of my favorite colors, called alizarin crimson. It's a beautiful red. And I was in makeup, and a great color for blood is alizarin crimson. Liquitex paints doesn't make alizarin crimson anymore, and good luck trying to find a substitute. For blue to the red, I like ultramarine blue. Sometimes a manufacturer makes it a little lighter, and then they have the darker version, which you should get, is ultramarine blue deep. For blue to the yellow, I like phthalo blue. Many manufacturers don't make phthalo blue anymore. One manufacturer calls it cyan blue, which is close to. In Liquitex acrylic, they call it phthalocyanine blue. I think that's how you pronounce it. or sometimes I have to use a Prussian blue by a manufacturer. I am not making any rule here, but I use these colors on my palette because I think they come closest to pure yellow going on either end. Of course, in the paint manufacturer, you might find a better color. Try to pick the colors that are closest to pure. But on my palette, I would really try to keep it to two colors to a primary color. Remember, if you look at a color, or if you buy a color paint, if you're buying yellow, it's always going to go to the red side or the blue side. If you buy red, it's always going to have a little yellow in it, or the other side is blue. If you buy blue, it's either going to have a little yellow in it, or it's going to have a little red in it. Okay, back to the color wheel. What happens when we start changing the chroma or the intensity, towards the center, you start getting browns. We'll talk about chroma and intensity later, but for right now, just know when you get closer to the center, it goes to brown. And lo and behold, they have three primary browns. The first one we'll talk about is yellow ochre. Almost all paint manufacturers make the color yellow ochre. In this manufacturer, Liquitex Acrylic, they only make yellow oxide, which is probably the closest to yellow ochre. The red brown is called burnt sienna. When I mix skin colors, especially in makeup, I use a lot of burnt sienna plus yellow ochre. Last but not least, the blue brown I like is burnt umber. With these nine colors on my palette, I could pretty much paint anything in nature. But if I can paint pretty much anything in nature, what about black hair? There is no black on my list. This is one of my favorite things when I teach color. It's like creating magic. If you mix ultramarine blue and burnt umber, you get black. Of course, in nature, there is no such thing as black. Let me take that back. If you're traveling in space, you might be able to see black in space. You're in a room with absolutely no light, that would be black also. But as soon as you would light a match, everything would turn to grays. This means in nature, when you see black, it's really different shades of gray. It looks black though, but there really are different shades of gray. In the case of black, you do use the words cool and warm, because black either goes to the blue side or black goes to the brown side. So when you mix, if you use a little more burnt umber, it goes to the warm side. If you use a little more ultramarine, it goes to the cool side. This brings us to the master of color theory, Joseph Albers. Here, his painting is called Black on Black, which he shows us the warm and cool blacks. In this video, it's very hard to see the exact colors of his painting. There are a few extra colors I use in my palette, especially when I paint sky. I like cerulean blue and sometimes Prussian blue. Again, this is not a steadfast rule. There are many blues, and actually there are many new manufactured blues. You pick the blue for the sky that you like. For landscape, I like a green called Terra Verde. It's an earthy green that is great for underpainting. For light color skin, there's a beautiful color called Naples Yellow. It's very hard to mix. Nice to work with for skin. This brings me to a story. When I was in college, I was trying to paint this still life, and I bought this cloth and laid it out, and no matter what I could do, I could never mix that color. It wasn't purple, it wasn't brown, I couldn't mix that color for nothing. Finally, the teacher came up to me and said, "You can't mix that because it's a dye color. It's not a natural color." The term here, dye color, doesn't mean dyeing clothes color. It means dye color made from a chemical.
So here's a brand of colors. And you could tell a lot of colors. Beautiful colors. And you could definitely almost tell the difference between the chemical colors. I mean, this is a chemical color, that's a chemical color. You can almost pick them out. This is a chemical color right there. That's definitely a color, chemical color. Some are a little more difficult, but some are very easy to see. Which is this definitely is a chemical color here, you know. But there are many colors. Right, this is definitely a chemical color.
A lot of clothes and plastics are made from these dyes. If you're trying to paint these colors, you'd have to buy that paint tube with that specific chemical color. Next, we'll talk about mixing colors, which is really a lot of fun and easy to do. When mixing a color, there's really only three parts or three steps. The first thing to think about is the hue. The next thing I call value, sometimes called a tint. The third thing is what I call intensity or chroma. On a color wheel, the rim would be the hue. The hue looks like colors, but because a color is made up of three parts, we're going to call the outer ring the hue. So the first thing is picking the hue that you want. Whether looking at a color or mixing a color, decide where it would be on a color wheel. For now, let's pick a color, any color. So for this spot, we have a blue to the yellow, which obviously it's phthalo blue or maybe Prussian blue. Okay, that was pretty easy. But now we have another spot, and this spot is green. Looking at the green, does it have more yellow, or does the green have more blue? In mixing this color, if the green looks a little more yellow, add more yellow. If it looks more blue, add more blue. On this spot, it's a more reddish purple, so obviously you add more red. All right, why am I showing you sheet music? Besides practicing your instrument, you also have to learn how to read music. Well, colors work the same way. You have to look at them and learn how to see them. With more and more practice, the easier seeing colors get. For me, it's easier to see colors than trying to figure out these notes. The first thing we'll do is work with some colored paper. The best color paper I know to use and to teach with is called Color Aid Paper. First of all, it's matte and not shiny, and comes in a lot of colors.
That's a yellow blue. And that's your red blue. Red blue, yellow blue. I don't know if you can see it in the camera, red blue, yellow blue. Okay? Again, this is a yellow blue. And that's a red blue. Red blue, yellow blue. This, that's a red blue, that's a yellow blue.
Here's the red blue, and here's the red yellow. Here's the red to the yellow, and here's the red to the blue. It's hard to tell if you can see it on your screen, but that's the red blue, and that's the red yellow. If you want to practice mixing colors, the best paints to use are either casein paints. Some of the best casein paints are Richardson, which I used when I studied color in college. Another good brand to study with is called Nikkor, and they have designer colors which are made out of gum arabic. There are also gouache colors. Here's Holbein gouache, but don't confuse it with acrylic gouache, which to me is an oxymoron. Either it's gouache or it's acrylic. With these three types of paints, when you mix the color and it dries, it stays almost the same color, plus they dry matte and they dry fast, whereas acrylic paints tend to dry darker. So here I painted some of the colors. I wanted you to see how some of them look.
You can see, this is yellow, this goes yellow, this goes red. Okay, this goes yellow, this goes blue. This goes blue, this goes red. If we want to do our opposite color here, so what color is that? Obviously, yellow, and then make green, or midori. That's green, okay? But you want to make a nice green, really pretty green. So you don't want to use with the red in it, and you don't want to use with the red in it, because we'll talk about that later, but that's going to make it a muddy color. So you want to use the blue to the lemon yellow, which is the blue, which goes to the blue side. This goes to the blue side. Okay, and this one goes to the yellow side. This goes to the yellow side. So that will make a nice green. So you got this color, and you want cyanide blue.
This manufacturer doesn't make phthalo blue or cadmium yellow light.
Your red to the blue, and your blue with the red. Okay, going to the red side. Red side, and we're going to here, we're going to drop down to here. Okay, so we're going to make this. So you want to use the blue with the red. Okay, your blue with the red, alizarin crimson. Alizarin crimson, and ultramarine blue deep is the red. So you're going to mix these two colors, which is here and here. You don't want to use this color or this color, that'll gray it. A nice pretty purple is these two. Now we want to make our orange. Again, you want to use the yellow to the red, and the red to the yellow, which is the red to the yellow is chromium yellow, and the French red,
This manufacturer doesn't make cadmium red medium or cadmium yellow medium. Here I added the secondary colors to my color wheel. Step two, or second part, is called value, which is really light to dark. Here are two paintings in values. A way to help see value is by squinting your eyes. Usually, you can adjust value by adding white. This brings us to the third thing to think about, is what I like to call intensity. Sometimes it's called chroma. This is easy to define as bright to gray or dull. One way to gray a color is to use its opposite color, or close to it.
I'm getting the yellow-blue, and the blue-yellow to make the green, and I'm using the alizarin crimson. So I want to go a little more yellow.
Here we have the opposite colors, green and red. This will change the intensity of the green or change the intensity of the red. Also, please note, if you add all three primary colors, you get gray. Here is the example of adding red and green, changing the chroma, and then finally getting gray. Here, the opposites, orange and blue, change the chroma, as well as finally getting gray. We spoke of this before, but usually before you get gray, you'll change the chroma to a brown. Remember, we have three primary browns, yellow ochre, burnt sienna, and burnt umber. Sometimes, instead, if you have a dark green and you want to change the chroma, you can use, instead of bright red, you can use burnt sienna. If you wanted to change the intensity of a dark blue, instead of making a bright orange, you can use yellow ochre and burnt sienna, which would be darker. When this really makes a difference is when you have a dark purple and you want to change that chroma or intensity. And for that, you'd add yellow ochre, which is darker than bright yellow. A few words about skin color. Even in a small area, your skin is usually made up of a few different colors. Usually a yellow color, a red color, and a bluish gray color. Here it's a little easier to see. The skin is just not one even color. When I want a lifelike mannequin, I paint red, yellow, and bluish gray skin tone dots. If you use one color for the skin, it'll give you like a doll effect. Sometimes people like this effect and use a one color foundation to even out their skin and make them look doll-like. Let's talk about cheek color. Most people, when they want to use a cheek color, don't know which color to pick. There is a way to decide on your cheek color. If you make a tight fist, you'll see a dark red. That is the closest to your cheek color. Here I've mixed the cheek color, that's pretty close, although I'm keeping it more natural. You could make it a little bit darker for a heavier makeup look.